You're tuned in to the Daily BS.
Do you believe it?
Sports and culture combined into one.
Michael on the drive across the lane. Turnaround shot. Got it. 63 for Jordan.
Are you kidding me?
He did what?
The Daily BS begins.
Bazinga.
Right now.
Right. Googly moogly.
Hadouken!
Hey, this promises to be fun.
Can't wait.
Okay, folks, normally I would lead off the show with, you know, a little subject, a little sports subject or a life subject or a funny husband story. But this time I decided to get someone, a very dear friend of mine, to ride shotgun. And this dear friend of mine asks a very important question, which is...
Did you miss me?
The one and only Mr. Controversy, Raphael Haynes, joins the show to kick off this day. How are you, man?
I'm good, Snowman. Trying to keep myself busy with no sports, but I'm good. You doing all right?
How are you keeping yourself busy? Besides your family, man. Because the last time I talked to you, your littlest one had just been born. And you became a father again. So how are you keeping busy without sports?
Well, besides the family, spend daydreaming about if Michael Jordan and Bill Russell could play against Vince Carter and Wilt Chamberlain. I've been trying to keep busy.
Can we just...
It's a mess right now.
There we go. There's our subject. Dream matchups. Dream NBA matchups. Because you and I have seen quite a few of them, and you just mentioned like one of the ultimate two-on-two matchups. Michael Jordan, right, and Bill Russell versus Vince Carter and Wilt Chamberlain. But actually, I'd make a switch. I mean, I love Vince Carter, but I'd actually put Julius Erving and Wilt Chamberlain on another side.
Oh, yeah, I agree. You know, I was kidding, but I think that's a good matchup right there. Yes,
there you
sir.
Go. There you go.
But, man, it's crazy because, like you said, going with what's going on right now, you know, we would have never thought. Well, I'll say this. I've always said this. Every time America goes through tragedy, no matter what it is, 9/11, the Boston, remember the massacre with the race, marathon massacre, whatever it is, we've always had sports to rely on.
Mm-hmm.
And sports was always that Band-Aid, always that outlet to where it took us away from the, you know, whatever was going on in the world. Even with stuff that goes on personally, if I got something going on with my family or work, anything personal is just horrible, I'm going through it.
Right.
I was able to take my mind off of it for 3 hours to watch this football game or 2.5 to watch basketball or baseball.
Yes.
But now when we're going through this pandemic, the one thing that we always knew we could turn to is no longer there.
Right.
So it's really hard for us to even cope with. And then the fact that, I mean, let's be honest, those of us that are married or have significant others, or even just by themselves, like, we don't have nothing, we don't have no outlet no more.
It's like, now what?
right. What? You know, I don't know what this life is like. I've never been here before. Like, this is...
I had a classmate some 30 years ago tell me if I ever stopped liking sports that I could give her a call. I haven't called her in 30 years, nor do I plan to.
Man, and, you know, so
it's something else. Isn't it?
And I like the fact that right now, one thing I have noticed is funny, because usually, and, you know, we all live in the social media world, and, mm-hmm. you know, we're me and you, you know, you and I, we have friends that both of us know, you know, we're acquainted with a lot of people that we each know.
Right.
And sometimes in the social world, some people, you know, you have the I don't want to sound corny, but some people could get jealous, or some people don't like this, or not even jealous. Some people don't just like the fact that I like LeBron and somebody else like, you know. But during this time, if you notice, Snowman, everyone has gotten along together. It's kind of nostalgic because it brings back those days when social media, Facebook, and all that first started. And remember, we would just always debate, you know, ask questions, who's better or who do you like?
Exactly.
And everybody joined in, and it was a good time. And it seemed like after a while, when everybody kind of branched off and wanted to, you know, create their own businesses or do their own thing, you know, we kind of got away from that. But now that we don't have sports, that's what we're relying on. And honestly, it's kind of fun.
It is.
I'm kind of liking it.
It is. It is fun because I did a segment on my show of why Roger Craig and John Taylor should be in the Hall of Fame. You know, those two are 49er fame from the 80s. Boy, I had some fun with some people that chimed in on that, and they're still chiming in on that. So it's like it's like you said, that Band-Aid, it's not there, but at the same time, it's creating another Band-Aid. We can actually debate now. Okay,
right. Debate and have fun, and people not getting their feelings now,
right?
Because we know what's going on, so we're having fun. We're debating, but it's still all in fun.
It's lunchroom.
So,
it's lunchroom talk all over again. It's high school lunchroom talk all over again. Let's go to the NBA and let's do some matchups. Okay, one of which we've seen already, and you know this one, and we're gonna do this in pairs, folks. And if you got a favorite pair, tweet the show at SNW Digital Media or follow this man, Mr. Controversy, the man in charge of the 3-point conversion, and let him know your favorite pair. Also, we saw this matchup in 1996: Jordan and Pippen versus Peyton and Kemp.
Mm-hmm.
We saw that one.
So, yeah, we saw that one. And you're asking for my opinion?
Yeah. I mean, we already saw the result.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. It's not even close, right? It's funny you bring that up because I was just talking about this the other day. Even though, of course, Pippen and Jordan destroyed them. But
yeah, they did.
I will give credit to Sean Kemp. That finals, Sean Kemp had a great final. I think he averaged close to like, don't quote me, 26, 27, but he had great games.
He did.
During that final. Like, he stepped up and showed me something like, wow, okay, this dude, he's really nice. He's playing when it counts.
Yeah.
So, yeah, but no, that's not even
close. I mean, okay, here's a dream matchup for you in terms of two-on-twos. And I know I'm really digging for this one, but Mark Jackson and Reggie Miller versus Peyton and Kemp. Outside tandem versus an inside tandem.
Man, you know what? Here's the thing, though. Here's the thing. That's a very interesting matchup because with Mark Jackson is probably one of the most underrated players of all time.
I'll agree with that.
In basketball. But do you put Peyton on Reggie or do you put him on Kemp? Because here's the thing. Mark Jackson, the reason why he's underrated because Mark Jackson, one thing, great NBA IQ.
Yes.
But a basketball IQ, I should say.
Yeah.
But he had a little floater, little teardrop. He was one of the ones that kind of created that, a teardrop.
Yeah.
And then his post-up game was very underrated.
Yeah,
post you up and back you down. He didn't use it just to score, but he used it to set up the pass. So you got him and Gary Payton, the only thing is, who would you put Gary Payton on? Because Reggie, as good as Reggie Miller was, most of Reggie Miller's game came off a screen, running around. So, you know, then you look at if there is just 2-on-2, I don't think they would be able to stop Seattle because we know Gary Payton can post you up as well. Payton can get by you. And then who's going to guard Sean Kemp?
True. Very true. One of the original men childs. One of the original men childs.
Right.
Okay, I got one for you. Here's a fantasy matchup for you. And I'm going across eras here. KJ and Dan Marley versus Mike Bibby and Chris Webber. So you got a little bit of the old school with the Phoenix Suns. And then you got that 2001-2002 Sacramento team.
You know what? Because we know that Dan Marley can't guard Chris Webber. You know he can't guard C. Webb.
Right.
But Bibby couldn't guard KJ. Like, it was a lot of people who couldn't guard KJ. Who could guard KJ?
This is why he's one of my favorite point guards of all time, because he was that unguardable. He was that unguardable, and he was also that fast. But here's a point guard matchup for you. We know KJ blossomed when he got to Phoenix. How about the fellow who stayed in his place in Cleveland, Mark Price?
And Mark Price and who else?
Let's go KJ and Barkley versus Price and Doherty.
All right. See, and I keep bringing underrated players, another underrated player, Mark Price. But, yes. Well, KJ and Mark Price. But Mark Price, indeed. He was one of the guys that Mark Price could shoot, but Mark Price could get to the hole. He was the best ice call when they would set the screen for Mark Price.
Yep.
The way he would use that screen, go between his legs. Mark Price is like, he's so underrated.
Yeah.
But then Doherty was too. Brad Doherty was too, but I just don't think he can stick Barkley. Barkley was too much for him.
Yeah.
I think KJ was too much for Mark Price. KJ didn't play defense like that either, so it almost might be a wash in a sense.
True.
But Barkley would be the big factor.
The only thing I hated about Doherty's career, it was cut short due to a back injury. I loved watching Doherty play. Doherty was that centerpiece for them.
You know who Doherty reminded me of? I know I'm going to get a stop. He wasn't as good, but Doherty was kind of like, and hear me out, was like the first Tim Duncan. What I mean by that is,
no, I actually agree with that.
No flash to Doherty's game.
No.
No flash to his game.
None.
But he was very fundamentally sound.
That's
very fundamentally sound.
And I give you no argument with that. Doherty was indeed the first version of Tim Duncan. I'm not gonna say stop it. I loved watching both of them play. There's a fantasy matchup right there. Brad Doherty versus Tim Duncan.
Yeah, and it wasn't that he was as good as Tim Duncan. I'm not saying that, but I'm just saying his style, no flash.
Right.
Everything was fundamentals. Good footwork. He just did
excellent
his job.
Footwork.
Grab, rebound, play. And he was just that, you know, like you said, his career was cut short. And I don't think, I don't think he would have been as good as Tim Duncan. But he was good. He was a good center. I mean, he made an all-star. I don't know if he made two or not, but I know he was one of the top, I guess, respected centers back then.
Indeed. Because, again, with his career cut short due to a back injury, he was leading the way into what would be the Tim Duncan era. And I give you no argument, because like Tim Duncan, Brad Doherty was very fundamentally sound. Fundamentals are... And I get so much flack when I say this statement. Fundamentals are missing in the NBA today. I miss having people that are fundamentally sound play the game. And then when you bring up folks like Steph Curry and Klay Thompson and others that do play with fundamentals, you get pushback for it. Lord knows I've gotten pushback for it, for saying it every single time. But if you think about it, when you have fundamentals, you have a better game.
Mm-hmm.
You absolutely
have
a better
game. That's what made, I think, and I know people are going to say, okay, this is the get off my lawn segment. No, it's not. But just where I came from, you know, watching the games, when, like we watched it, back then, the greats, and it's kind of like that now in a sense, some of them, but back then, your best players were fundamentally sound, all of them. Mm-hmm. Barkley, Jordan, they can be the greatest, they got flash, but they always good at fundamentals.
Absolutely.
You know, they all had it.
Absolutely.
The footwork, the, you know, it, the preparation, the, all of them had it.
It was
and
all there.
You look at today, some of them, like you mentioned Steph Curry. He's like that. I don't think LeBron is fundamentally sound. I think he's more athletic. Mm-hmm. You know, he has that athletic ability.
And that's been my biggest argument against LeBron. You know, people don't hear me out. Listen carefully, folks. I've always said that LeBron is a very gifted athlete. He's a very gifted athlete. Problem is, he's not a fundamentally sound basketball player. That's all I've been saying. You know, and people want to throw numbers at me and throw the stats at me. You can throw them at me all you want. My argument remains. He's a great athlete, but doesn't have a complete set of basketball skills, fundamental basketball skills. That's always been my argument.
Right. Yeah. And like you said, because he's so athletic and he's gifted, he doesn't have to use all that. Now, I will give him this. The last 3 or 4 years, he's worked on his fundamentals.
That
and
he has.
You see in his game, you know, because as athletic as he is now, even still in the year 17, he lost a little bit of that, you know, athleticism.
Absolutely.
But still, and I think that's why now you see him with the 11 assists. Like his IQ, he has a great IQ. And, you know, I still don't think it's the greatest of ever. I don't agree with that. But
his
IQ is up there. It's high. Basketball IQ is up there.
It is. It really is.
And he knows basketball, you know, but, and that's why he's able, I think, now to get lead the league and assist at year 17 and still be able to score 25 points a game. And because, you know, he doesn't depend on athleticism like he used to, just that. He's gotten better. I still don't think he's one of the top fundamentally players, you know what I'm saying, that he knows or he's great at. No, I don't think he's great at his fundamentals are great, you know, using them. Like, no, I don't think so. But he's gotten better. I'm not saying he doesn't have any at all. It used to be where he could play. It was just all athleticism, which that's how he could. That's how good he was. But I say that when he first came to the league, he was like, okay, like LeBron is a bad boy, but he's an athlete.
I think now
he's gotten better.
He has.
But I say it
is later
athlete.
Years.
Yeah,
and I've said this on my program, and I've said it on social media, and you've seen me say it on social media. I've never said that he's not a gifted athlete. He's a wonderfully gifted athlete. He's just incomplete he's gotten better in his later years. Do not get it twisted. He's gotten better in his later years, but he was just so much a raw talent and not a complete basketball player. That's been my argument. And people have always, and you've seen the responses I get on social media, people always mistake that for hate instead of asking questions. Like, why are you hating against LeBron? I'm not hating against LeBron. Hear me out, please. He's gotten fundamentally better, especially in year 17. Do not get it twisted. He's gotten better, but he didn't come into the NBA with that fundamental package.
No, he didn't. I mean, and like you said, he didn't have to, I guess, because he was that. He was good.
He was playing bully ball since year one. He was playing bully ball since year one. But when
he was.
Yeah. Oh yeah. But when he gets and here's my other argument against LeBron, and we'll close this chapter here because I plan to have you back for another conversation. my other argument against LeBron is defensively. Okay? I mentioned the fundamental package. It's not all the way there. Has it gotten better? Of course it has. Okay? You got, when you last 17 years, when you're in year 17, hey, you've done something right. And I'll never say he's done something wrong. But at the same time, I had a question about his fundamentals. I've also had a question about him defensively. Because defensively, he can step up in spots. He can step up in spots, and he has. He just hasn't done it consistently in his 17 seasons. And I make the comparison with people want to make the comparison between him and MJ. And I had a young fan, and you're going to love this one. I had a young fan ask me, name something that Michael Jordan has that LeBron doesn't. I said, let me take you back to 1988. There's a certain award we like to call Defensive Player of the Year, which MJ got in 88.
Man, I still don't think people understand how great of a season that was.
Yeah.
Jordan.
Absolutely.
So Jordan, he won All-Star MVP, won dunk contest. Okay. This man averaged 37.5, I think, that year. 37.5 and 88. And this guy still won. He led the league in scoring, still won the Defensive Player of the Year. Who does that?
And he led the league in steals.
How can you be the leading scorer? And yes, how can you be the leading scorer, but yet still be the Defensive Player of the Year? Who? Oh, has anybody done it besides a center? I don't even
besides
know if a center,
the center
has done it.
No. Was a league MVP and Defensive Player of the Year not in the same season? No,
not in the same season. League MVP, he won the scoring title.
He did.
Won the scoring title.
He won the scoring title
and Defensive Player of the Year in the same year. I don't think no one's done that.
It was kind of a quadruple play if you go back to 88 because MJ was the scoring champion, second of 10 in a row. Yep. For all you LeBron fans, listen carefully. Second of 10 in a row in terms of scoring titles. He led the league in steals. He was the All-Star Game MVP, and he was the league MVP.
Yeah.
And this is before the dynasty years. This was before the dynasty years. And remember, the Bulls won 50 games that year. They lost Pippen for part of the year due to a back injury. Pippen wasn't starting. He didn't start until the playoffs. But they lost him for part of that year due to a back injury. So people got to remember, MJ was still shouldering the load while the Bulls were figuring out who to put in the lineup. I got to let you go, but tell everybody where they can find you, my friend.
Man, first of all, thank you for having me, Snowman. I appreciate it.
I love you, brother. It's always fun to have you on.
Yes, sir. And you can follow me at Instagram or at Twitter at Mr. Controversy 21. Also on Facebook, just look up Controversy Raphael. And the 3-point conversion, look us up. We got a 3-point conversion Facebook page. Also on all social media platforms at the 3-point conversion is 3PTCN. VRSN, so at 3-point conversion, or you can just put up the 3-point conversion and our YouTube channel as well. Make sure you follow the 3pointconversion.com.
Man, please follow this man and his team and everything that he does. You have a 3-point attempt, you got a 3-point play, and then you got this man with the 3-point conversion. He is Mr. Controversy, Controversy Raphael. I love you, brother. Thanks for coming on today.
No problem.
Got more for you, folks. Sit back, relax, and strap it down. More after this. We'll be right back.
You're tuned in to the Daily BS. Sports and culture combined into one.
Welcome back to the program, folks. Don't forget that you can hit us on all of our social media using the ID SNW Digital Media. That's SNW Digital Media for Facebook, Snapchat, Instagram, Twitter, and Pinterest. And speaking of having some great guests on the show that we distribute through all of our social media, don't forget to check out our Patreon as well. Uncle Smoothie is back. Chris Williams has joined me. How are you, my friend?
What's happening, partner? Thank you so much for bringing me back. I must be doing something well.
Yeah, you're doing a lot of things well. Man, listen, all right, this is the one of the few times where I'm going to be a fan. What the hell happened?
All right, well, there's a lot going on. What the hell happened concerning, be more specific for me. A little bit more specific,
with,
man.
With our
there's
sports,
a lot you can say that to.
I know. Boy, isn't that the truth. That's a conversation for later. That's probably a conversation for Snowman Unfiltered, and that's a shameless
no
plug,
question.
As you all know. But the sports world has ground to a halt for very good reason.
Yes.
Don't get me wrong. Very good reason.
No doubt.
But damn it, I'm a fan.
No doubt. Well, you know what? Right now, obviously, safety comes first.
Indeed.
But guys like you and myself who love sports, right now I'm a little bit more, you know, I'm still active. I can play a little bit here and there. So It's a tough time. It's so tough, man.
Yeah, it is.
Only thing we can really kind of sink our teeth in is a little bit of football news.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
You know, during this time period, so much that's usually going on. So we're in a tough spot.
I miss March Madness so much.
Listen, Snowman, I am so disappointed from that aspect. I did the last basketball game on ESPN as a color commentator of the 2020 season.
Yeah.
I did a MAC tournament game, Siena versus Fairfield, which was the last game that they shut everything down with.
Yeah.
So during that time period, everyone was just so disappointed. The atmosphere in the arena was so down, Snowman.
Yeah.
You know, the players, parents, coaches, people working in the arena, because obviously we didn't know what was going on.
Right.
And we had just heard that a number of tournaments were shut down. I believe that day, the Big East tournament, at halftime, had shut down. We finished up our game, which was the last one. No fans.
Yeah.
So that wasn't a great atmosphere to begin with, but we thought we would at least be able to get through it. So you just know everyone was so disappointed, and the faces on those young people was, it was the worst.
I saw the report. I saw the reports flying in. You know, when I checked out of work, I saw the reports flying in. Big East was canceled. Big Ten was canceled.
Correct.
Pac-12 was canceled. I mean, the cancellations were flying in by the second.
Yes, they were.
I
believe the MAC conference was the last one to cancel.
They were the last one.
Therefore, we were the last game that was played, which was a tournament game, obviously, to try to figure out who would go to the NCAA tournament.
Yes.
And nothing conspired, and everybody was just so disappointed.
Yeah.
They had to shut everything down.
It's disappointing, but it's a safety issue. And when you have a safety issue, you have to take every precaution necessary. And I say
no
it on
question.
This show.
And you're dealing with young people who are amateurs. I think that's important also. And you have to take that in consideration.
You have to take everything into consideration, especially the safety of the fans, the safety of the players. It was thought of by the NCAA that they were going to have the tournament games without fans, which would have been a weird atmosphere. And you experienced that.
It would have been very weird, but at least we would have had it.
Yeah.
And I've seen reports and I've read up, just doing a little bit of research on it after everything was canceled.
Yep.
A number of people were looking forward to at least trying to get the tournament going.
At least the first four in Dayton. At least the first four in Dayton. But if you don't have the fans and if you don't have the players and this pandemic spreads and in a closed area, it could spread very, very fast. And it could also bring a lot of panic, which is why Adam Silver shut the NBA down, postponed the season, and said, we're going to make sure the country, we help the country get this under control first before we resume any games. And he's looking into arena availability come August because he wants to get this season complete, which brings this question to you. Do we start over with the NBA or do we complete this season? Your thoughts?
I really think we complete the season if it comes to that point. A number of players are putting a lot of hard work, coaches and all these groups, and you want to try to finish up something that you started. I don't think it would be fair to start over until you start a new season.
Fair enough.
So I would be a fan of starting exactly where you stopped off, because you have the number of players who've had really good years. You know, you have that MVP race, and I've seen you go back and forth. Well, actually, you know what? I haven't seen you go back and forth. I know you have a clear-cut winner.
Yeah, and it's Giannis.
Obviously, you know, people want to throw their hat in that ring also. So I would like to see it start where it ended, in my opinion.
Yeah, yeah. You want to pick it up where you want to pick it up where you left off and get some questions answered. Can Milwaukee finally complete the picture and get their first NBA title since 1974?
Yes.
Can the Los Angeles Lakers get their first title since 2010? Those are the two big storylines. Can the Golden State Warriors swing a trade for Karl Anthony Towns and get themselves back in the competition and have a good end to this season?
Oh, you're getting deep, man. I like it.
I'm just getting started. I'm just getting started. Can the Warriors swing a trade for Karl Anthony Towns and bait Minnesota with Andrew Wiggins? And I put this rumor out there 2 weeks ago, and I think it's going to happen. Can the Houston Rockets use microball to get themselves to a title? My answer is no, but I know other people will say different. Let's go on.
Well, check it out.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're throwing a lot at me. Let me just jump on one. Can I jump on one, please?
Take a couple.
Because I love watching your Facebook feed. And if anyone doesn't know, the Snowman gives you a lot of good nuggets out there. And I sit back and watch and laugh and comment here or there.
Yeah.
But one I have to jump on. The Houston Rockets. I've never been a fan of the way they play. Unfortunately, because James Harden is so good of a one-on-one basketball player, he gets a lot of love, and I give him kudos for that. But there's no way the Rockets can win playing the way they play. And it's sad that we feed into a year in and year out. There's no way you can win playing like that, Snowman.
Amen.
And then you bring Westbrook over, and that just really just ruins him.
I'm glad I'm not the only one that thinks that.
Neither guy can do it by themselves. It's unfortunate.
And they've tried.
So I just want to tackle one of them.
And they've tried.
Oh, no, they try. Because the NBA season is so long, you're going to have games where guys are going to have big numbers. And they are that good where they can score a lot of points and be effective on certain nights.
Mm-hmm.
But in a seven-game series, when it becomes more close-knit, grind-out type affair, the scouting reports are intense.
Yep.
There's no way you can play like that and beat someone in a seven-game series, especially if it's a good team when we get into the playoffs.
And Lord knows they've tried four of the last 5 years.
Oh, yes.
They've run into Golden State, the kings of microball. But here's the difference between the way Golden State plays microball and the way Houston plays microball. Golden State spreads the ball around.
Right.
Golden State has had a big man.
There's movement.
Golden State has had a big man to depend on. Anybody remember Andrew Bogut? Anybody remember Kevin Durant?
Indeed.
Anybody remember Zaza Pachulia? They ran the ball through Pachulia, and they've gotten some effective shots.
And they play better motion offense, whereas the Houston Rockets play ISO basketball.
Yep.
So there should be an argument from someone who's listening who say, well, listen, Snowman Smooth, how dare you say that? The year they had Chris Paul, they took the Warriors to a seventh game.
Yeah,
and you're exactly right.
Because
of Chris Paul, who's a solid point guard who understands how to play playoff basketball. That's why they were that close, and they possibly could have beaten the Warriors that year.
No.
But not with Russell Westbrook
He does. I say no with Chris Paul, and here's why. They should have closed them out. I'm speaking of the Rockets. In 2018, they get a 3-2 lead. They hold the Warriors to under 100 points in Houston in Game 5. They should have closed them out in Oakland in Game 6.
Oh, yes, they should have. You're right. I totally agree.
An 11-point lead at halftime, and you only put up 25 points in the second half, and you get mauled.
the bottom line is it comes down to the isolations.
Yep.
And when that game was closed out, you were going to Harden and letting them go one-on-one.
Mm-hmm.
And it's tough. It's tough to do that in the playoff series.
It is.
Because night in and night out, everybody's going to make adjustments. That's the one great thing about professional sports. You're not going to continue to get over on your talent and your athleticism. Somebody's going to make the adjustment.
Yeah.
We see it in all sports, football, mm-hmm. basketball, Lamar Jackson. Nobody can catch up. Somebody's going to catch up with you sooner or later.
Oh, yeah.
It's going to happen.
The Tennessee Titans caught up with him and made him a one-dimensional player.
It happens.
On a Saturday night, they made him a one-dimensional player, which is the one thing I was afraid of with that Tennessee defense. You know, right. the Warriors made the Rockets one-dimensional, while the Warriors did not. And here's the biggest difference. In the series in 18 and 19, the Rockets had the Warriors down, but did the Warriors go away from what they do best? No.
Never. Well, it was a championship pedigree that they established. It's in their DNA. They stuck with what was well for them, and it works.
It
they
does.
Won championships during it. The Rockets haven't done it yet, so I don't understand why they're going to stick with it. And it's unfortunate that D'Antoni continues and consistently gets a job in the league. I can't get it.
Yeah, I don't really get it.
I'm not one of those guys who advocates for people getting fired, but I just don't understand how year in and year out this man has a gig in the NBA.
I don't get it either. You know who should be coaching the Rockets right now, but it'll never happen? Kenny Atkinson.
It probably will not.
It ain't going to happen for two very simple reasons. James Harden and Russell Westbrook. Just like Kyrie Irving, and I'll get to him in a moment. Just like Kyrie Irving.
Oh, yeah.
Just like Kyrie Irving and Kevin Durant got him out of Brooklyn. And the Brooklyn Nets should still be the New Jersey Nets, but I digress.
Duh, my man, Snowman. Well, check this out. Let's make this clear. The NBA is a players' league. They run the league. Those guys decide on who should be their coach, what they're going to do. In most cases, again, I've been in some NBA huddles.
Yep.
Whatever play that's run by the coach is decided by those players once they get on the floor.
True.
Huge Philly fan. You know, I'm born and raised in Philly. Loved Allen Iverson. But the story was always that Allen Iverson did his own thing. Larry Brown would run some excellent plays.
Mm-hmm.
But once these guys get on the floor, this guy goes solo.
Yeah.
But he's so good, it works.
Yeah, it works. It works.
It works.
For a while, it was Michael Jordan.
Now, the type of coach that usually works in the NBA
mm-hmm.
for teams that are trying to get across that hurdle, a coach who's won a championship. Obviously, there's not that many of them out there. Those are the guys who put their foot down and demand certain guys and certain teams to do what needs to be done because they can always bring that ring into their face.
Yep. Yep. And Larry Brown tried to do it with Allen Iverson.
Yeah, that's a tough one.
Yeah.
That was a tough
one. You know what's crazy? Michael Jordan was that way for a while, and then Phil Jackson showed up and put his foot down. But the difference being, I love Allen Iverson. Don't get me wrong. Love Allen Iverson.
Same here. Let's make that clear. Like I said, born and raised in Philly, I would always jokingly tell people, Allen Iverson can take four guys off the street and win a couple of games in the league without mm-hmm. That's how good he was.
But again, Michael Jordan was Allen Iverson for a while until Phil Jackson showed up. The only difference being Michael Jordan was willing to listen, and it made him better, and it made him greater. Bronsexuals, listen carefully. Two things Michael Jordan did that made him greater, he was willing to listen, and he implemented everything that Phil Jackson put in his head. Because Mike knew, especially with the Detroit Pistons, it was a mind game more than a physical game.
Yes, indeed.
The Pistons made it physical. Indeed. Michael Jordan made it mental, especially in 1991 when the Bulls swept the Detroit Pistons. And what happens when you have a leader willing to listen to a coach? It filters down into the teammates. Just ask Stephen Curry. Just ask Klay Thompson. Mm-hmm. Just ask Steve Kerr. Steve Kerr played with Michael Jordan.
Yes, he did.
Steve Kerr played with
him. I can't remember what year was that snowman.
1997.
Knocked down that mid-range jumper.
1997.
Jordan called that in the huddle before they came out.
Yep, and Michael just looked at Steve and said, "You be ready." And Steve looked at him back and said, "I'll be ready to knock it down." And he knocked it down. When you have teammates like that, and I'm leading right into Kyrie Irving with this, folks. And a lot of people are going to be upset with me, but I don't care. I've discussed this on my show. You've heard me discuss this on my show.
Let's hear it.
The Kyrie experiment in Brooklyn needs to end now.
Well, I'm just going to talk this out as a debate point, which I love. It hasn't started yet. I agree with you. I don't think it's going to go well. But we like to see both of them on the floor because as a star, when you become a superstar, in my opinion, is when you understand you have to share. You have to share, and sometimes you have to take a step back and sacrifice. I want to see both of them on the floor together and see what happens. But that's the area where most stars have a problem. Understanding they have to share and sacrifice some of their game to make others better.
Which is why I feel right now the Nets won't win a darn thing, because you have a player in Kyrie Irving that won't share. Talk to LeBron James
about that.
Well, we haven't
seen him and KD together yet. You got to give him the benefit of the doubt.
No.
In fairness to him.
Fairness? You want to talk about fairness?
Yeah.
He had 2 years to be the leader in Boston, and it went sideways.
Agree. What I believe happened in Boston, Kyrie comes in, he wants to be the alpha male, and those young guys, Brown and Tatum, those guys were very, very good. I don't think he realized how good they were. And they had done so much the previous year.
Yep.
And they were bitching like, listen, man, we can't take a step backwards just because you came here.
Right.
We still need to shine. Jason Tatum is going to be an MVP candidate before it's all said and done.
Next year.
He's that
I'm calling it right now. Next year, he will be an MVP candidate.
Yes. And I don't think he needed to be a sidekick. And
no.
Kyrie learned that early on. And another issue we haven't touched on, Kyrie's injury prone.
That's obvious.
You got to be able to play 82 games or at least come out and show me I'm the leader. I can sustain my body, being able to tell you what to do and being able to do it myself. And be out there able to play. And he hasn't done that for a full season in a while.
I don't think he's done it. I don't think he's done it in the last 7 years.
I don't even
years.
Think he's done it his entire career.
I don't think he's done it in the league. I don't think Kyrie's played a full 82 games since he's been in the league.
Right.
Hell, he didn't even play a full season at Duke. He played 11 games.
Right. Well, I said throughout his entire career, he's been very injury prone. Now, for him, what he's excellent at, he's a huge, big-time player in closing moments. He does well when the lights are on. He closes out games, but he's a one-on-one guy. He likes to pass
mm-hmm.
the rock.
Mm-hmm.
He'll give it a headache. But when you're playing with other good players, they need to touch it also.
You know what?
That's why Kemba Walker is a much better fit for the Celtics.
I love Kemba Walker.
Than Kyrie.
Love Kemba
yes.
Walker as a fit in Boston. I made this argument on my show, and I want to get your thoughts. The same big-time shot that made Kyrie Irving also broke him. And I'm talking about the shot he hit in 2016 to beat Golden State and win the title. That shot made him, and the next season broke him because he got
Explain how it broke him. I need to get a little bit more insight on how it broke him.
In simplest terms, he got cooked in 5 games. He got absolutely blistered because the Warriors figured out what to do. They sent different people at him, and Kyrie could not handle it. It wasn't just Stephen Curry guarding Kyrie Irving. That's the match. If you're Kyrie, that's the matchup you want. You don't want to see Klay Thompson.
Oh, no question about it. You want that matchup, yes.
You don't want to see Klay Thompson. You don't want to see Andre Iguodala. You definitely don't want to see Kevin Durant. It was a height difference.
Right.
C. Kerr figured out, okay, it's going to be a height difference. So let me send
some length and athleticism on a guy like Kyrie.
Yeah, and Andre Iguodala baked him in an oven in the two games in Oakland, especially the final game. And I love the fact that Steph got his revenge, and that's a selfish pleasure for me when Steph brought the ball through his legs, wrapped it around him, got Kyrie one way, leaned the other way, and banged home a three that clinched the title. And, you know, and Steph just looked back and said, we're even. Okay, we're even.
Right.
So, and then Kyrie was out of there.
Let's take a little bit of the emotional bias out of it, because it sounds as though you're a Warriors fan. So I'm going to squeeze a little bit out of you from that standpoint. In fairness to Kyrie, again, I like this advocate that I'm playing here. Kind of reminds me of First Take, what we're doing here. So Kyrie, exceptional one-on-one player. That's what he does well. So at the end of games in the NBA, you don't need to call a play for him. Give him an ISO.
True. I'll give you that.
Clear out a side for him. He's going to get to the basket or get a shot that he wants.
I'll give you
which
that.
Which he did to close out, right, which he did to close out the championship season that 1 year.
Yes.
I don't know the years. I know you're good with numbers.
2016.
We talked about how teams at the NBA level, NFL level, at the professional level, make adjustments.
Yes.
Warriors make their adjustments. Understand you need to put some length on him.
Mm-hmm.
You need to put some height on him, some athleticism on him. He's still a very good one-on-one player, but
truth.
Him not understanding that he needs to share, he could have made other people better.
So do you think that happens
in Brooklyn?
But I think
that selfish mentality
yeah.
was still in his head. I can close this out on my own. Because at that stage, LeBron wasn't even the closer
no.
for the Cavaliers.
No,
they would
wasn't.
Allow Kyrie to close out games.
And that was the move that the Cavaliers needed to make. They needed to build around Kyrie. And if you really want to think about it, when LeBron returned, that deflated him. When LeBron yeah. returned to Cleveland, that deflated Kyrie because they for 3 years, they built around Kyrie Irving. They built around him.
Right.
And then LeBron comes back. Some people go packing, and then Kyrie's going, now what the hell do I do?
Well, it was certainly some alpha male issues with Kyrie
mm-hmm.
and LeBron.
Mm-hmm.
I think Kyrie, after making the shot in that first championship season, was basically, I'm an alpha. I really believe I can have my own team. I know Kyrie had a really great relationship with Kobe. I think maybe some of those discussions were there.
Yeah.
But I don't think he was mentally prepared to have his own team. We saw
that.
It firsthand in Boston.
Yeah.
It's more than just what you do on the floor. We
mm-hmm.
talked about him not being able to go an entire season without being injured.
And being,
all this plays out.
And being a leader in the locker room.
How he handled the media on certain occasions. Certain things he said. He hadn't grown and matured to the point to be an alpha. And we haven't seen just yet now if he can be the alpha in Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm giving him the benefit of the doubt. I think it's a growth process. I think it's part of your maturity. But if you want to be the true superstar that we believe you can be, you have to make other people better.
And he hasn't
You have to
yet.
Make me feel good about my game, make me feel good about making shots, make me feel good about being on the floor at the end with you. If you can't do it, can I feel comfortable enough to know, Kyrie, you'll get me the ball, and if I make it, you're happy for me. A la Ron Artest, Metta World Peace, Kobe gives him the shot, he knocks down a three, and he jokingly says, Kobe passed me the ball.
Yeah, 2010. And that sealed the that sealed the championship.
Right.
That's
you have
the
to
biggest
make
difference.
Other guys, other players around you feel good about what they bring to the table.
I'll close with this point. I've had so many people dive into my argument of LBJ versus MJ, and I said the biggest difference is Michael Jordan made his teammates better. And I've had people argue with me, well, mm-hmm. LeBron's made his teammates better. Okay, let me pose a question to you. Has LeBron ever had that much confidence in Kyrie where Kyrie would knock down the winning shot and people would throw 2016 at me? And I say Kyrie did that on his own. He didn't do that, you know, with the push from LeBron that LeBron was supposed to give him. Steve Kerr is a different story. Steve Kerr had the confidence from MJ after Kerr missed a big shot in Game 4. Game 6 at the United Center, Mike looked at Steve, and Steve looked back at Michael, and Steve said, I'll knock down the shot, and Steve knocked down the shot. That's a big difference.
Right.
For me, that's a huge, huge difference. That's Uncle Smoothie, Chris Williams, talking a little hoops with yours truly, the Snowman. Tell everybody where they can find you, my friend.
My man, Snowman, is always a pleasure. They can find me on Instagram, Hear Chris Speak, Twitter, Hear Chris Speak, and if you're still on Facebook, like the older ones, like you and myself, Chris B. Period, last name Williams, WILLIAMS.
All right.
Now, Snowman, you have to let me give a rebuttal
Go
on
ahead.
That last point.
Go ahead.
I got to come back on the last point. because I love your emotional bias. We know you love the Bulls. We know you love Chicago.
That's my hometown. That's my hometown. I got to bring that up. All right, finish it.
Now check this out. In all honesty, both guys make people better. LeBron has always made other people better, and that's been his knock. He's always played the game the right way. The difference between those two is Michael is a certified killer. He goes for the neck, smells blood, and he will not let you go. LeBron, more, okay, you know what? I'll let you play for a little bit. Let's make it competitive and see if I can do something here. No, Michael wants to snuff you out. I love the way Chauncey Billups made the comparison of the two. He said the difference between the two is no one could eat when Michael was on his watch. He kept so many superstars from winning a championship.
Yes.
Ewing, Barkley, all these guys. None of these guys sniffed it when Michael was on his watch because he wanted to step on your neck. And as Chauncey said, everybody eats during LeBron's reign. So I'm going to sum it up that way.
And there's truth to that. Shout to Chauncey Billups with that.
I love that, man.
Mr. Big Shot himself, Chauncey Billups with that quote. Thanks a lot, my friend. I really appreciate it.
Last one, Snowman. I can't let you go without this. Give me a little bit of Dave Zinkoff since you went into announcers.
And
can I get the doc?
From University of Massachusetts, captain of the Eastern Conference Championship team, Julius the Dr. Irving.
That's from my Philly fam. Each time we talk, we gotta close out with that. That's classic.
Gotta have Zinc to close it out. And I got some old Sixer games when they used to be on CBS. I got some of those now in my library, and I'm loving it. Thanks a lot, my friend. I truly appreciate the time.
I appreciate it, partner. Thank you so much.
More for you in a deuce.
Tuned in to the Daily BS. Sports and culture combined into one.
All right, I got a question. With sports being... Here's our question of the day. I forgot to introduce it the right way. Oops, and I'm getting yelled at right now by my producer, and she has every right to yell at me. But here's the question of the day, and it goes a little something like this. With all of sports basically being halted... What are you binge watching app, either on cable or Netflix or Hulu or Vudu, which my wife got me turned on to, by the way. What are you binge watching right now? After football season last year, we binge that show. She says, have you ever seen Downton Abbey? What the heck is Downton Abbey? Now with sports being halted, you know what's got me hooked on now? Baking championships. And y'all know me. I love that, which I have to calm down off the get out, okay? But these people are creative, man. I need to try that. You try that. I'm going to be in a coma. And she goes, you really want me to try this? Then shut up. Yes, ma'am. Basically, the extent of the conversation. And, of course, we sit and laugh at each other the whole time. But she got me hooked on these. She got me hooked on baking championships and cooking shows and house flip shows. That, which I would take my eyes off that show. I don't care if there is, like, two important grits in front of me that I'm working on. All I have to hear her say is, honey, the holiday baking championships are on. Okay, cool. We're turning on like right after the during football season. We didn't even watch the Sunday night game. So while sports is halted, we're watching that, getting all kinds of ideas and recipes and all that stuff. You would think with me, with the folks who know me, it would be a crime show. It would be, no, it's baking championships, and I love them all. I love them all. Especially when it comes on during the right time of the year, like Halloween. I think Halloween is how we got started in watching it together. I think it was Halloween 2 years ago. And I'll tell you what, I wish I was a judge on those shows, but I'd have my taste tests at a minimum in my kitchen, at least until I come bring you a part of a mixer to lick or a spoon or something like that, okay? But all kidding aside, question of the day is, with sports delayed, what are you binge watching? Tweet the show at SNW Digital Media or 9 to noon. Tweet the show at SITM 9 to noon or SNW Digital Media. Let us know what you're binge watching. More after this.
You're tuned in to the Daily BS. Sports and culture combined into one.
Time for a little Transition Tuesday. We're going to get back into doing this consistently, and Russ Williams has joined me. How are you, sir?
I'm doing well, Snowman, doing well. Hey, Snowman, I had a question for you. How you been able to cope during this time not having sports? How's it been for you, my man?
I was just going to lead with the question of what the hell happened? Anyone who knows me, I'm from Chicago. One of my favorite voices is Neil Funk, and he was the radio voice of the Bulls for a long time. And after a game against the Lakers where the Bulls came back from 22 down, I have to borrow what he said, which will lead us into Transition Tuesday. A lot of this world and a lot of this country has got to be shaking their head saying, what the hell happened? It's ground to a halt. I got a lot of old school stuff on my computer to keep me going. I got a lot of cartoons to keep me going. And that's how I opened the show, talking about other stuff that I've used now to get. But wow.
I have the same sentiment as you, Snowman. I'm looking at on ESPN. We're looking at dodgeball competitions and throwing rocks like skipping off the water. We're reduced to this now. This is the new normal.
I mean, this ain't 1979, is it? When ESPN first started, Fox Sports wasn't even in competition. You had TBS and TNT. Well, before TNT. TBS was on the air long before TNT. TNT came around in 1988. TBS was around in the 80s. CNN was voiced by the great James Earl Jones to take us in and out of breaks. But then I hate saying this phrase. This is the new normal, and I'm only finding a couple of ways to cope. It's helped. Having great guests like you on has helped. But
I appreciate that.
Again, wow. What the
heck? I think everybody shares your sentiments there, Snowman. Wow. What is going on?
What the hell happened? I finally said it. People have been waiting for me to say it. My friends get a hold of me and they said, you haven't asked the one question we're waiting for you to ask. My wife looked at me and said the same thing. She's like, I'm so surprised you didn't say the question you wanted to say. Well, now y'all have heard me say it. You heard me say it at the top of hour one. You're hearing me saying it now. What the hell happened?
Snowman, I guess I had to bring that up. I had to bring it out of you, huh?
I tried being good about it, okay? And look, I'm making a joke of this, folks, but I'm not making a joke of the coronavirus, all right? We want you to please continue to take care of yourselves so this can be defeated immediately and some kind of normalcy can resume. Wash your hands whenever you come out of the bathroom or wherever you do anything. Sanitize your hands. Keep yourself in a good, healthy rhythm, okay? If you feel sick, stay home, please, okay? If you're sneezing and coughing and you feel any kind of fever or flu symptoms come around, do not, please, folks, I beg of you, do not take any chances. Just stay home and get well, okay? I make light of this situation, but I'm not making too light of it because it can happen to anybody, including yours truly. That's why I'm making sure I keep myself healthy. Drink plenty of fluids. You know, if you can get your exercise in the house, please do that. But we just want everyone to take care of themselves. Now, on to Transition Tuesday. What you got for me? And I think I know what the answer is.
Well, you know, as we transition to our new normal, not only in sports, but in life, got some game plan steps, some GPSs, I like to call it. And the first GPS I have is I'm going to take a quote from Brad Pitt in the movie Moneyball. And he said the following, adapt or die.
Yes.
We have to take this approach when we're transitioning to the new normal. You know, the new normal for us is going to be how we adapt when our sports come back. You know,
right.
The NBA is slated to come back in June or July. We have to adapt to that process. You know, all the different sporting events and everything. We have to adapt. We also have to adapt to what's being shown now. So mm-hmm. if you have to go on NBA TV and watch, you know, the finals in 1995 and 94, it's a matter we just have to adapt.
Yeah.
And we have no choice. You either adapt or either you die, as Brad Pitt eloquently said. So
yeah,
that's
yeah.
the first GPS. Yep. Second GPS, and I think this could be related to like sports and in life, more in life, is we have to be kind to one another, especially in this crisis.
Absolutely.
We got to be kind to one another.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't cost you much at all. You know, I'll share a story with you, Snowman. I'm in the supermarket. I live here in New York, so I'm in. So, you know, the pandemic has really hit New York pretty hard.
Yeah.
But you always have an opportunity to be kind to one another. I'm shopping in the supermarket. It was this elderly lady, it was a small lady, she had a mask on, she had her gloves on and everything. She was trying to reach up to the counter to get a can of peas. Obviously, she couldn't do it. So she just summons to me. She goes, "Hey, you mind helping me?" Now, you know, I'm 6'4", and all, I can help her. I
right.
could have took the approach, be like, "Hey, lady, I'm trying to get my stuff like you."
Exactly.
Disregard that. But I was like, you know what? I'm going to be kind to this lady. This lady reached out to me, and I was kind to that person. So it's contagious. You know, it doesn't cost anything. And I think when we're kind to one another, especially in this pandemic and in this crisis that we're going through, you know, you have no choice to be good and to be kind. And that's how we get through the process. We get through the process together by being kind to one another.
Absolutely.
And showing each other empathy as well, too. I think we've missed the boat on this. We got to empathize with people. We got to empathize with those people. You know, like I went to BJ's and I was shopping there and it was a long line. So you have people arguing with the people who are checking you out.
Right.
You know, you got to empathize with these people. You got to put yourself in their shoes. You know, how would you feel? So you got to empathize with each other, and you got to be kind to one another. So these are the two GPSs that we have to really practice when we're transitioning to our new normal.
So true. So true. And kindness is going to help us get through this more than anything else. Taking care of yourself is one thing. Staying home while you're feeling sick is another thing. But the kindness, and you hit on it so expertly, my friend, the kindness is going to get us through.
And you know what, too, Snowman? I'm hoping ESPN is kind with us, the viewers, because I know they've been teasing that Michael Jordan, that 10-part documentary, saying coming
yep.
soon.
Yep.
They need to be kind to us. They need to put that out now instead of waiting to June. That way we can be kind to each other by watching that.
So
we
you
need
know,
some help out here, Snowman.
You know why they're waiting until June, right? They anticipated waiting, I believe, until the end of the World Championship Series. Yeah. They were waiting till the end of the World Championship Series, and I think all the footage, from what I've been told, is from 1998, which is why it's expertly titled The Last Dance. You know, all they needed to do was to come to me or a few others from Chicago that lived that last dance. But I've seen clips of it. I've seen and heard how ultra-competitive Michael Jordan is. I mean, come on, who didn't know that? Who didn't know
right.
how ultra-competitive Michael Jordan is? And we'll close with this note. It's a big difference between today's NBA and the NBA back in the 80s and the 90s. Would you not agree with that?
I definitely agree. Absolutely. The physicality, yes, true. That is so much true. That's the major difference.
I mean, you don't... I tell you what's fun. I found some old Philadelphia 76er games, and I'm talking about 1980 through 1986, where the changing of the guard okay. happened from Julius Erving to Charles Barkley. I found all of the World Championship Series games when they swept the Lakers, and I'll leave you with two names, Maurice Cheeks and Andrew Toney.
Ooh, Andrew Toney, the Boston Strangler.
The
that
Boston
guy doesn't
Strangler,
get enough credit.
Absolutely. It's just so sad that his career was besieged by foot injuries. imagine how much he would have done in Philadelphia, because he spent his entire career in Philadelphia. Imagine how much more he would have put up if Cheeks and Tony were to have stayed together in the backcourt at least until the end of 1989 or the end of 1990. Because after Tony, unfortunately, was forced to retire, that's when Philadelphia drafted Hersey Hawkins to move into that spot. But just imagine if you want a what if. I'll leave y'all with this before we go to break. What if Andrew Toney could have stayed healthy for his entire career instead of having it be besieged by foot injuries? Man.
That is so true. That is so true. Yeah. Very underrated player, Andrew Toney. Great player. You know what I used to like, too? Snowman, I used to love Bobby Jones.
There you go.
Here's a guy, a white guy, dunking on people and everything. I used to like that guy. The Secretary of Defense.
And I have a game in my files now in its entirety. It was aired on CBS in 1986 where the 76ers broke a long Celtic winning streak with a three by Julius Erving. It was in the Spectrum in Philadelphia against Boston. And the strangest of occurrences, Larry Bird missed two free throws to open the door.
Whoa.
you don't.
We'll probably see that game. That game will probably appear on NBA TV as our new normal right now. Look, so we'll probably get to see that game. No,
if I can help, and I'll air it through my YouTube channel, make sure all the credits go where they need to go, and people will understand the kind of NBA you and I grew up with. That's Russ Williams. R Will Transition is how you can find him on Twitter. R Will Transitions, pluralize that, is how you can find him on Instagram. And reach out to this man on Facebook. He has Transition Tuesdays every Tuesday night. It's a fabulous program. I was a part of it. And you got another podcast you got going, do you not?
Yes, I do. The Russ and Kayla Neese Experience. You can hear it on iTunes and Spotify and Google Podcasts and all and major podcast platforms as well.
Well, you can count me as a subscriber. I had a chance to listen to it, and I absolutely love it. Keep doing it, my friend. Thanks for the time.
No problem. Thank you. Thank you, Snowman. I'm going to have you on there as well, too.
I can't wait. I cannot wait. And I can't wait to get back to y'all in a deuce. We'll be right back.
tuned in to the Daily BS. Sports and culture combined into one.
We are rocking and rolling on the show, folks. Thanks for tuning in. Don't forget to follow us on all of our social media. The ID you need is SNW Digital Media for Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, and Pinterest. Now, let me bring Rick Curdy back onto the program. I'm trying to make him a weekly guest while we work on getting sports back going again. He joins me now on the other side of the hotline. Rick, how are you?
Hey, Snowman, how are you?
I'm good, man. It's good here in Carolina, I'll tell you that. Minus not having sports, it's good here in Carolina, man.
Oh, there's nothing finer than to be in Carolina.
Absolutely. Absolutely. let's start by talking a little XFL. You know something?
Sure.
I have to admit something. Before the coronavirus pandemic hit, I was hooked. I was hooked on the XFL, man.
It's a great league. I've been following it. I mean, first day when Mr. McMahon did his press conference, because I remember the old one, and I thought, oh, that was so gimmicky, and it was stupid, and it was like wrestling.
Yeah, it was.
And the whole, you know, nicknames in the back, and you know, I'm like, oh, Lord. And then when I heard it was coming back, and I was like, oh, come on, dude, seriously? But then when I heard his press conference, I said, oh, wait, this is, like, totally different.
It is.
The only thing that's the same is the name. That's the only thing that's the same is the name. I said, even the logo looks different, the colors. And then a little by little, I was like, man, I got hooked on it. And I mean, I'm not kidding you. I didn't watch any NFL. I waited 2 years for this thing to come out because I love everything I heard about it. The quicker games, fewer stoppages, no politics involved, just play football. And I thought that is exactly what I want. And man, I saw the cities being announced. I love the names and I love it. And, you know, it sucks that it ended, you know, like everything else because of this virus. But they're going to be back in February 2021. So he has it funded for the next 3 years. So we'll see what happens. And there's rumors that they might expand to other teams. So we'll see what happens.
You know something? If I have to pick an underdog team, it would be St. Louis. Because, man, their fans really got behind that team.
St. Louis is a great sports town. Twice they've been screwed by the NFL. First with the Cardinals.
First with the Cardinals.
When they moved to Arizona. And then, of course, with the Rams. Mm-hmm. And they just were left hanging. You know, usually when people leave, it's because they don't have any fan support. They had the fan support. They just had greedy owners that wanted their own stadiums.
Yeah.
And I felt bad for the city of St. Louis because, I mean, they love the Cardinals. I know the St. Louis Blues won the Stanley Cup. So it's a great sports town. And, I mean, I remember when the Hornets left.
Yeah.
And that sucked. I remember living in Los Angeles when the Raiders moved to Oakland, and Oakland's 10 hours away from where I grew up. So it was like them moving to another state.
Yeah.
So it sucks. It sucks, especially when the fan support's there. It's just the owners are so greedy and want a new stadium. And then look what happened to the Raiders. They didn't get their stadium, and now they're in Las Vegas. So, mm-hmm. I mean, it's crazy what happens. But St. Louis, I mean, yeah, not really surprised by the fan support there because they're so hungry for professional football there.
And it was awesome seeing how the fans got behind them. Like you said, the fan support was there. You know, people want to say, oh, the fan support wasn't there for the Cardinals. Wrong answer. Yes, it was. It's like you said, the owners were so greedy for their own stadium. I mean, why couldn't you strike a deal where you could turn Busch Stadium into grass and run it that way? Because the Cardinals kept that stadium for another 19 years before they moved to the new Busch Stadium in 2006. I mean, it was so much that could have been done to keep the Cardinals in St. Louis. And the best thing that this XFL has is a football mind running it in Oliver Luck.
Yeah, I mean, he was the greatest hire in all of sports. You know, when I heard, you know, when Vince McMahon hired Oliver Luck, and that brought so much credibility, and I think a lot of people were like, whoa, he got Oliver Luck. And I'm like, as commissioner? I'm like, that brings instant credibility, hiring Bob Stoops as head coach for the Dallas team, June Jones, Pep Hamilton, you know, Mark Trestman, and it's like, wow, this is like legit. I mean, they got some good coaches, and he saw players coming, and he saw stars like P.J. Walker and Jordan Te'amau, and, you know, that were like, wow, how in the world are they not in the NFL? These guys are sensational.
Oh, yeah.
And now a lot of these XFL players like P.J. who's coming to the Panthers, I'm excited. Cam Phillips is outstanding wide receiver for the Roughnecks. I think he's rumored to either go to Cleveland. They're not sure yet. But a lot of them are being signed by the NFL right now. So there is a lot of talent in this XFL league.
It really was, and it was fun to watch. Like you said, it was the shorter games. Some of the cities, Houston, St. Louis, you know, that have fan bases already established. And Vince McMahon and Oliver Luck went to those towns, put teams together, Washington, D.C., Seattle, Washington, Tampa, Florida. They were all there. And now with P.J. Walker being one of the first to sign with the NFL, oddly enough, signing with the Carolina Panthers, you know, now you got some credibility that may be in the operative word, return to the NFL.
Yeah, I mean, we'll see what happens. It all depends about this virus that is just stubborn and won't go away. And every time you think it's going to get better, then something else happens. So, you know, we're all in the waiting process. We have a stay-at-home order right now in North Carolina that our governor signed.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just sad that people are not taking it seriously. And people need to take it seriously because this is something that, you know, I mean, not having any sports, I mean, it's crazy. The last time I remember this was 94 when baseball canceled the World Series. I think the hockey went on strike. I think basketball started late because of players association disagreement. So this is the closest thing I've ever had to not having any sports. So it really sucks.
It does. And 1994, boy, what a year that was, especially when it came to the lack of sports. And we nearly saw it again in 2011 with the NBA holding out till basically Christmas Day. It's tough. And I had one of my previous guests on the show said that sports was like our Band-Aid, especially in this country. Now we don't have it, but you get a chance to talk to people. And I want to remind everybody, please take this coronavirus pandemic seriously. Please take care of yourselves. Stay home. If you're ordered to stay home by your government, just comply and stay home unless you absolutely have to depart the house. My wife and I do because we work at a place that's essential. And we get up early, go take care of business, and then we come back. And then I'm rolling this show for you guys. But, you know, something my wife said to me about, you know, being essential, when everything came to a halt sports-wise, she looked me dead in the eye and said, you're essential because you got to bring something to the fans that they can talk about, whether it's old school or new school. And she's right. That's why this show keeps rolling.
I know. It's something really serious. And, you know, some of these corporations are not taking this seriously. You got a lot of these warehouse places where they're saying, well, we're essential, but it's like you got like 200-300 people working like elbow to elbow, and I'm like, that's not safe.
Right.
You know, and so some of these companies, unfortunately, are just thinking of the almighty dollar and not really taking care of their workers. So, like I say, people need to take this seriously. They need to stop going to the parks and throwing picnics, and they need to stop having pool parties and, you know, this is serious. I mean, this thing does not care who you are.
Right.
I mean, Prince Charles got it. You know, Kevin Durant, you know, Sean Payton, Tom Hanks and his wife. You know, this thing don't care. It don't discriminate. It
James
just goes
Dolan
after anybody
got it.
It wants.
How about that? James Dolan got it.
James Dolan. Doris Burke just tested positive for it. So, this is scary, man. I mean, it's really scary, and I just tell people to be safe, be careful, and no place is worth your life.
It really isn't. Rick Curdy joining me here on this program, talking of coronavirus, talking how to be safe, and talking XFL. And believe me, when the XFL comes back, this is my expert on the sport. I'll have a couple of them for each league and each sport that we cover here on the show. Thanks a lot, my man. I really appreciate the time.
Thanks, Snowman.
I got more stuff for you, folks. Back in a flash. Hey, thanks for listening to the show. Glad you're tuning in across all your favorite mediums. And don't forget, the podcast version is available 1 hour after this show completes. But I'm here to give you a trivia question, and it goes like this. Who is the only team in Major League Baseball history to turn two triple plays in the same game? Think about that. Let me know your answer. You can follow us on Twitter by following SNW Digital Media. Tweet your answer there or follow us on Facebook. Give me the answer after this message. Didn't think I'd leave you hanging, did you? Here's the answer to the trivia question, the first of many that I'm going to have on this show. I asked the question, who's the only team in Major League Baseball history to turn not one, but two triple plays in the same game? The year was 1990, the date was July the 17th, and the team you'll find accomplishing this feat was the Minnesota Twins. They're the only team in Major League Baseball history with two triple plays in the same game. Want to know a side note about that game? They lost 1-0. Can you believe that? Back in a flash.
Tuned in to the Daily BS. Sports and culture combined into one.
Welcome back to the program, folks. Thank you for joining us. For all programs distributed by Snowman Digital Media, just follow us at SNW Digital Media on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, and Pinterest. Let's go back to the NBA, and I welcome back Desmond Johnson into the conversation. We talked Carolina Panthers earlier. Now let's talk Charlotte Hornets. What do they have to do first and foremost to get back into, let's just be honest, a competitive range?
Wow. they need some experience. They need experience right now. I mean, yeah. I like the core of what they've kind of put together with Devontae Graham, P.J. Washington, Miles Bridges. I'm not sure about the future of Malik Monk. With all the coronavirus stuff that's going on and the canceling of the season, it kind of got lost in the shuffle that Malik Monk just got indefinitely suspended by the NBA for some sort of drug usage. And they never said what the drug was. Usually if it's marijuana or something, it comes out. But with this one, they were very vague about what it was that he was on. And, Coach Borrego for the Hornets, in his statement for it, basically just said they were there to give him any kind of help he needed. It was more about that than it was anything else. I'm not really exactly sure what's going on with Malik Monk, so I can't really even include him in the core going forward. But P.J. Washington and Miles Bridges, Devontae Graham, I like those as a building block. They feel like they would be better if they had just that one LeBron, Durant, Kawhi, like, superstar. Because the NBA is the only league where if you've got one superstar, you got a chance to win an NBA title. You don't need two or three or four. That kind of got tipped the past couple of years. you got two, you got a great shot. And with Charlotte, it's more of a matter of the only way they're going to get that is through the draft. Like, no one's going to come there as a free agent superstar and turn Charlotte into whatever. But any star they've had that's even near that level, whether it's Larry Johnson or Kimball Walker, they've gotten them through the draft or some sort of trade of some sort. But even then, that hasn't resulted in that type of level of player. The type of level of player where you're saying that guy's a top 20 NBA star, Larry Johnson at the time when he was with Charlotte, or mm-hmm. Kimball Walker towards the end when he left. You could say Kimba was a top 20 guy. He was an NBA All-Star that year and was a starter, if I'm not mistaken. So, yeah, you could easily say that. Those all came in the draft. So Charlotte has to draft somebody that could take them to the next level. And I don't see that person in this year's draft. Maybe James Wiseman, but the center is so obsolete now in the NBA, I don't know if that would be the guy. I was high on Cole Anthony at the beginning of the year. I'm not so high on him to be in Charlotte now.
No, I'm not so high either. You think the Hornets miss a little bit of Kemba Walker right about now?
I think they would have been just fine if they hadn't signed Terry Rozier. If they hadn't signed him and just saved the money and just let Devontae Graham start, if the whole purpose was to let the young kids play, there was no reason to spend money for Terry Rozier when Devontae Graham is clearly a better fit for the offense that Borrego wants to run. Rozier will have some nights where, yeah, he'll go off for 25, but he's so up and down that I don't think it's helping at all. And with Devontae, they kind of have a diamond in the rough. He's a second-round pick. He was a Big 12 player of the year his senior year at Kansas. He's been in big pressure situations. He was shooting crazy from three-point range,
mm-hmm.
like over 40%, if I'm not mistaken. He should be the starting point guard for the Hornets. If they're worried about name brand recognition and that kind of stuff, Terry Rozier ain't it. So he's kind of wasted money on Rozier to come in and do what? I mean, he's doing the same stuff that Graham could have did, but worse.
Yeah, absolutely. Because I was wondering why they made the move for Terry Rozier, why they signed Terry Rozier. Anyway, you can't judge everything Rozier has done on one playoff series. I mean, Rozier, if you look at that, or one or two playoff series, if you think about it, because Rozier was forced into duty with an injury to Kyrie Irving, and I'll touch on him in just a moment. But you can't judge anything on a player that was forced into duty that was, to me, in a better system. Rozier is not for that Charlotte system.
I agree. It's almost like they were like, I think they panicked. I think the Hornets panicked. Like, when they realized they weren't going to be able to sign Kemba Walker back and that he was going to leave for real, I honestly feel like they did not expect Kemba to leave. I think that they expected Kemba to stay and to take the money and to give him a little slack on the contract on top of it, and that way they could build around him or whatnot. But I didn't think Kemba was going to stay. He didn't have a reason to. He's in a much better situation now in Boston. And when that happened, it left them with this bag of money that they couldn't give to Kemba. So they're like, well, we got to give it to somebody. And Terry Rozier was just kind of standing there with his hands out. So, I mean, honestly, I'd be more than happy if they could trade Terry Rozier to open up some minutes for Devontae Graham. And if they end up with, a situation where I don't know what's going to happen with this season, but if everything freezes where it is and they have the draft in June or July, I think the Hornets were going to pick 7th or 8th. Cole Anthony's going to be sitting right around there probably if he comes out, which he probably will. Do you draft Cole Anthony?
That's a good question.
That's a question I'm not answering. Because, at that point, at 7 or 8, if Cole Anthony's still sitting there, he's probably the best player available. He's still in need playing point or shooting guard. He's coming from Carolina, so there's a little bit of a rooting interest there. You know that with Jordan and everything else, their history with picking Tar Heels. Does he go to Carolina? Does he go to Charlotte? That's the decision they would have to make, because then they're going to have a glut right there with Rozier and Graham and Anthony and not enough minutes to go around.
What is another pressing need for the Charlotte Hornets?
I personally think I think James Wiseman would be a good pick for them if he's still there, because he's a pure center. And there's not a lot of those left in the league, but if you look at the teams that actually have a pure center, they're usually pretty good, whether it's Denver, you know, Zion is pretty much a center. He's just an undersized center.
Yeah.
And they were starting to play pretty well in New Orleans. If you look around, like Utah, Rudy Gobert, defensive player of the year a couple times now, got the teams that have an actual center, like I consider Bam out of Iowa center with the Heat. And they were playing great. If you like, it hasn't gone away. I think Golden State's warped this mentality of everybody needs to be shooting threes, or Houston's out here shooting 63s in a game and playing small ball. But the basketball is always going to be about who's more talented, who's taller. And if you've got some big guys that can do a lot of things, that opens up the door for everything else. You put someone like James Wiseman on the front line with P.J. Washington at power forward, Miles Bridges at small forward. You know, you put, let's say Monk does come back. Monk's at shooting guard, Devontae Graham's at small at point guard. That's not a bad lineup. That's not a bad lineup at all in the Eastern Conference. In fact, that's probably a 4 or 5 seed in a couple of years as they get older.
True.
So, I mean, that would be the mentality I would have. I'd be trying to find a big man.
Let's stay in the East. And one of the teams, and you and I have spoken about this off the air, one of the teams that gets so much ballyhoo and gets so much props, but to me hasn't proven anything is the Philadelphia 76ers. And they got two big problems right now. One of them is Joel Embiid. The other is Ben Simmons.
Yeah, I think they're going to have to trade one or the other. Problem is, which one of them do you trade? Because Ben Simmons had some injury issues. He was out as everything ran to a halt, and they didn't have a date for him coming back. And I don't think Joel Embiid's ever played an 82-game season. I think he's always been nicked up with injuries. So, I mean, who do you choose? Do you choose Embiid or do you choose Simmons? I don't think that they can keep both. They could keep both, but I don't think they will.
Well, you got four players on that team that have plus $100 million contracts. How do you shave that?
Somebody's got to go. And out of those guys, I mean, it's got to be one of those big two. You got to pick one of those guys to be the face of the franchise and try to get something for the other. And again, I'm a big man fan, so I lean more towards Embiid because I would say when healthy, Embiid is the top 10 player in the league, maybe top 5 when healthy. I can't say that about Ben Simmons. So Ben Simmons is like top 20, top 25 to me, but he can't shoot. So I mean,
and that's why I don't give him even top. That's why I don't give him even top 25. Ben Simmons cannot shoot.
He can't shoot. He's big. He's a almost 7-foot guard playing, and he can dunk. He can drive into the lane, do all that, but until he can develop at least some sort of mid-range jump shot to be respected, I would go with Embiid, to be honest. I would keep Embiid and try to trade Simmons for either part to complement Embiid or a bunch of draft picks so you can get them on your own.
Now, here's an idea that someone brought to me, and I want your thoughts on this. What if Ben Simmons is kind of scaling himself or positioning himself, I beg your pardon, to be traded to the Lakers? A, how would the Lakers pull that off? And B, how would Ben Simmons fit on that team?
Well, for me, if you see, why would the Lakers want him? like, I mean, unless it honestly, like,
that's beautiful. I love it.
Why would they want him? It doesn't fix any of the problems the Lakers have. I mean, the Lakers' biggest problem is that they don't have guards that can shoot.
Right.
Yeah, they don't have a shooting. They don't have a shooting point guard. They've got guys that can plug in like Danny Green and KCP that can shoot the ball.
But they don't have pure shooters.
Shooting point guard.
They really
right.
Don't.
Like right now, the point guard is LeBron. Yeah, LeBron's the point guard. So I mean, bringing Ben in, I think it was a success having LeBron at the point guard position. To be honest, I think it was a perfect move for him. He was leading the league in assists. I think he was having an MVP season. But I don't. Yeah, Ben Simmons there doesn't fit. I think he'd fit more someplace like, honestly, a place like New Orleans, but they don't need him either. I think Lonzo Ball is going to be great there with Zion as a partner for years to come.
And I'm glad Lonzo's doing better. I'm glad Lonzo's doing better. He got away from Los Angeles. He got away from his father, and now it just seems like it's all beginning to click for him.
Yeah. And we didn't even talk about draft-wise, another guy to look out for. His brother LaMelo.
Yes.
He's grown. He's like 6'8". He can shoot better than Lonzo. People are saying he might be the number one overall pick, which I don't understand because that would be going to Golden State. But and they definitely don't need a point guard.
No, they don't.
I don't know, but yeah, I'm happy for Lonzo too. I think he'll never be a great superstar like Jason Kidd. That's who everyone's comparing him to, but I think he's got a chance to be a solid 10-12 year pro in the league. And he'll have some games where he's got, like, you know, double digit assists and that kind of thing, but he's never going to be like a flashy superstar.
How about James Wiseman to Golden State? That would solve a lot of problems for them. And
I thought that's what they would do. That's literally what the pick I expect them to make is James Wiseman.
Yeah.
Because then they put him at center. You get Steph back. You get Clay back. You get Draymond back. And you have Andrew Wiggins playing small forward. So he's a more athletic version of Harrison Barnes, who was on the team when they won 73 games or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then you upgrade the center position. Like, Golden State would be reset to go off for another 5 years.
Yeah.
Nick Wiseman lives up to high.
Well, I'm going to talk about this next segment, but you just brought up a very good point. And like I said, this leads into the segment I have after the break. The Warriors are positioning themselves, and this is what a lot of people are not looking at. The Warriors are positioning themselves for the second part of their dynasty. Not second half, but second part of their dynasty. Because as long as they're the Splash Brothers, the Warriors are still breathing.
Yep, and the thing people don't realize, too, you can still shoot like that in your mid-30s. Like, some of these other things the teams have, they're based on athleticism, and when that athleticism starts to go away because of age, they start to decline. Shooters are shooters. You can shoot like that at 40 years old. Like, mm-hmm. Clay and Steph can get off their shots without dribbling the ball. Now, Steph obviously is a better dribbler than anybody in the league, really. I think he's got the best handles than anybody other than maybe Kyrie.
Absolutely.
But Clay, we've watched Clay. What was the one game he scored like 60-some points and took 29 like four dribbles?
In 29
like
minutes.
Or whatever.
Yep. He took four dribbles that entire game, and he dropped 60 points in three quarters.
Not only do I love the nickname, I love the Splash Brothers. They are my favorite duo right behind Jordan and Pippen.
Thank you.
In NBA history from what I've been watching. They're just so fun to watch, and I miss it. I miss them being out there. I miss the NBA. This is usually the time of the year when I'm watching NBA heavy.
Yep.
March Madness is ending. You know what I mean? Like, I'm getting into that basketball mode and getting ready, and I was all ready for, you know, I'm a Laker fan. Grew up on Showtime. And I was ready for almost a coronation for LeBron again, because I watched him talk smack about him and that he was washed. And he came out on a scorched earth tour this year. And now I don't know if we're going to see the end of it. Like, I don't know if we're going to see the third part.
I don't know if we're going to either. But again, I'll talk about this next segment. But people don't understand. The Warriors are positioning themselves for the second part of their dynasty. And B, you mentioned something that I love talking about. The Splash Brothers remind me of every duo that played in the Golden Era. Jordan and Pippen, Magic and Kareem, Maurice Cheeks and Julius Erving and anybody on that Philadelphia 76er team, Bird, McHale, and Parrish. Those teams right there.
Yeah, I can see that. I felt bad for Clay when Kevin Durant showed up in Golden State, even though he was part of the contingent trying to convince them to come over.
Mm-hmm.
But I look at it like, you know, Clay's not considered in many people's eyes a top 20 player when really he is, in terms of what he can do and how he shoots. Like, he's one of the better shooters ever, like, in NBA history. And he doesn't get a lot of credit for it because Kevin Durant was there for 2 years and overshadowed him, really. You know, Steph even took a back seat when Durant was there. But people forget how good Steph Curry is. He's the only unanimous selection for
most valuable
the MVP
player
in history. That's, you know, Wilt, Jordan, Shaq. Like, none of them did that. Like, and Steph Curry did this and won back-to-back. It's just like people sleep on how good they are. And I don't think either one – I think Steph might have just turned 30 recently. But he's, like, at the halfway point of his career.
Yep.
Like, they've got another 7-8-year stretch here – where they can keep this thing going and really do something.
I'm reminded of the words of Paul Pierce. This is not the Golden State Warriors. This is the Golden Empire. They're taking a year off because of all the injury, and they're getting ready for another run. Trust you me. Desmond Johnson joining me while he's on the road and while we're getting it together. Man, thanks for coming on again here on the show. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, man. Anytime. And I got a... get you on. We're going to try to do this NFL greatest team ever bracket on the rundown, and I'm inviting media personalities to take part
in trimming
the field down from 6-4 to 1. So I'll be in touch with you about that soon here, too.
All right, man. Thanks for coming on.
All right. Appreciate you.
My final thought concerns the Golden State Warriors after this.
Tuned in to the Daily BS. Sports and culture combined into one.
Let me thank my wonderful guest in Desmond Johnson, who appeared not once but twice on this program talking Charlotte Hornets and also talking Carolina Panthers. Rick Curdy discussing the XFL. And did you miss him? Mr. Controversy joining me to just reach around all parts of sports, including the NBA, and how we're both handling the coronavirus epidemic and the lack of live sports going on right now. Folks, please take care of yourselves with this coronavirus pandemic going on right now. Be good to each other, even if it's from a distance. Practice social distancing. Stay 6 feet away from each other. And if you're in a place where you essentially have to go to work and your job is deemed essential, go in, take care of business, get out, and get back home to your family, okay? Now, let me do a little NBA chat right here to close the show. And I want to lay a warning. Rob Parker, who was a good friend of mine and one half of the Odd Couple, said the Warriors dynasty is finished. Let me say that again. And I'm going to work Cole Johnson into this conversation as well. And I plan to have him on later in the week, if not next week. We're trying to work out a time. But Rob Parker said that the dynasty of the Golden State Warriors is finished. What? Why would you say probably the silliest thing that you've ever said? And this is a good friend of mine. Again, he's the host of the one half of the Odd Couple on FS1 and Fox Sports Radio and iHeartRadio. And this program's on iHeartRadio also. But Rob, I touched this in a segment. Why are you saying that when all the Warriors are going to do is reload? Okay? And I know the exact pick, the exact draft pick that's going to put them back over the top. Well, first of all three of their draft picks, Steph Curry, Klay Thompson, Draymond Green, are going to come back, and they're all going to be healthy. Secondly, you got Andrew Wiggins that you can work as a swing forward, and I still think the rumor is out there for Karl-Anthony Towns or Giannis Antetokounmpo to end up in Golden State. But then again, you got a back-to-the-basket center by the name of James Wiseman that could end up in Golden State. The guard play is already there. They're working on solidifying their bench. All they need is a big man that can solidify the center position the same way that DeMarcus Cousins did in limited opportunity. The same way Andrew Bogut did. The same way Zaza Pachulia did. Believe me, the Golden State Warriors will be back next season. They will be back. You've already seen what Stephen Curry can do, and he's already graced the Chase Center with a couple of big games. But don't sleep on this team. That would be a mistake. It would be a mistake to sleep on Steve Kerr and the Warriors. A couple people said, now we'll see what kind of coach Steve Kerr is, and they've labeled Kerr a fraud. Why are you doing that? You could be the best coach in the world, but if you have ratty players, there's not much you can do. If you have a rash of injuries, there's not much you can do. But if you had the players that your team selected for you to coach, then you're going to be absolutely fine. Excuse me. The Warriors are in this position. The Warriors are positioning themselves for another 7 to 8 year dynastic run. I'm reminded of Paul Pierce and what he said after the Warriors clinched the title by beating up the Cleveland Cavaliers in 2017 in 5 games. And they clinched the title at home in Oakland. This is not the Golden State Warriors. This is the Golden Empire. 1 year or 2 years does not take away from a dynasty, especially when I believe the Warriors are going to come back stronger than ever. Period. They're going to come back stronger than ever, much stronger than ever. So don't sleep on this team. Don't sleep on this organization. They're the class of the NBA right now. Everybody else is just wearing a Band-Aid. The Warriors are shooing the Band-Aids, and they're getting completely healthy. And they're about to do it sooner than later. A lot sooner than later. Don't sleep on them. That would be a very critical mistake. But they're going to sleep on them anyway. People are going to sleep on them anyway. People are going to sleep on them anyway. Shouldn't do that. Should not do that. My time is up. So is our time together. Hope you all enjoyed the show as I enjoy bringing it to you. Tomorrow, got some more great guests, more great subjects. And I want to remind you guys, please, please do your best to help contain this coronavirus. Have a great day. God bless. Remember to make your next move your best move. And always remember, if your dreams don't scare you, then they are not big enough. Dream big, do bigger. I am, and I hope y'all are too. Got more for you tomorrow. I'm out of here. Talk to you tomorrow.